Hi, my name's Everett Minchel. I'm a machine learning engineer, and in today's video, I wanted to go through some pricing data. I went on Kaggle and found some data that Walmart put out there of its sales throughout the year and other features like the temperature, whether it was a holiday or not, et cetera, et cetera. And the goal here was to forecast what the sales would be in the future, so predicting sales week by week. In this instance, I treated it as a regression problem. I think in a later video, I'll go through it again with more emphasis as a time series, with a time series model, that is. But let's go ahead and jump in and I'll show you how I approached this problem. And I was actually able to get a 99% accuracy with some good metrics. So let's go ahead and I'll show you how I did that. So welcome to the Jupyter Notebook. Let's go ahead and get started. I think it'll be best if we just zoom on through the code here. I'm not going to go through everything. I'm just going to highlight what's important. These are just like, the basic. I use these in every notebook. So it came in three different training data. So we have the features, the training data, and the stores, which we merged all together. And yeah, and then just it created two columns with holidays. So we just dropped one. And this is our ultimate data frame here. As you can see, there's quite a few different features, including markdowns, is holiday, weekly sales, and the date. Fuel price, CPI, unemployment, the type, and the size. The only values that were missing were in the markdown values. I, including some that were over 60%, all of them were over 60%, except for 73 here. That's pretty high. I think ultimately later in the notebook, you'll see that I've dropped a significant amount of them. But in terms of just going ahead and looking at the data during the exploratory part of the process, I just filled in those NA values with zero. And you can see that, yeah, we have no more there. I made a pivot table of the weekly sales by department and store here just to get a better idea of what kind of sales we were looking at. In some of the instances, you can see that some departments had like negative sales or no sales, which doesn't really make any sense. So that was something that had to be addressed. I just looked at all the weekly sales that were less than or equal to zero, because it just doesn't make sense that a department would have negative sales for the entire week. So I just treated that as a mistake. It could be that perhaps the department had to refund someone, but I feel like it's not appropriate to put negative to put that aspect of the situation in the sales column. If I were working with a real stakeholder, or like in a production setting, I would definitely be talking with my team to decide how to handle that. But even so, by dropping these, you can see here that it's only 0.3% of the entire data frame that we would be dropping due to that. So it's not going to make a significant difference, really. But still, if there was something there that was important that other members of the team that had put the data together felt like it should stay, that 0.3% might make a big difference. We just call describe to try to find any weird statistical anomalies here. I can't remember if I saw anything that stood out to me. I think for the minimum weekly sale. Yeah, so the minimum here is zero, is like not even a penny or a penny. That's how much they made, and for the in a minimum, that's pretty odd to see. But it's again, it's probably just one value out of 400,000 values, it's not something that's really going to make a statistical influence on our prediction capabilities. So next, I wanted to see what kind of difference a holiday made in the weekly sales. And it makes a huge difference. I don't know if you can see this very well, but the orange is it is a holiday and blue is that it's not a holiday. So on the weeks where it is a holiday, we're actually seeing greater weekly sales. So being a holiday is extremely important in our prediction here. And that just intuitively makes sense. If we look at the dates, it seems to fall on February 12th, February 11th, February 10th. That's probably Super Bowl time, September 10th, September 9th. That's Labor Day probably. And then November 25th and 26th. That sounds like Thanksgiving. And then around the New Year's, New Year's, Christmas. So though that's prime holiday shopping season, so it makes a lot of sense why that would be prime weekly sales. That even outpaces the rest of the other weeks. And went ahead and took a look at different stores to see what kind of weekly sales we're seeing amongst each store. Did the same for each department. You can see here that the 39 department has no weekly sales, or it's just so low you can't see it. 99 is also not making much, 78. And we can see that other departments are making like way more. So 92, 38 might be something worth looking more into if need be. But for our purposes, we're going to move on to the type. I went ahead and color-coded it with it being a holiday or not. So even across multiple types of Walmarts, it is the same story. So if it's holiday weekend or if it's holiday week, you're going to see more sales. With the exception of C, we'll see this come up more and more throughout our presentation here because type C seems to be an anomaly compared to the other Walmart store types. And this one here is the distribution of size. So you can see that distribution sort of broken up, or you can see that the size of the stores are sort of broken up into three distinct sizes here, meaning that the size of the Walmarts, I think more or less could be small, medium, and large. So to make it a little bit easier and not a numeric value, I changed size into a categoric value because it just looks like the distribution is distributed amongst a pretty evenly three ways, small, medium, and large here. And so we're going to look at the same thing, but we're going to use category size as well. So what this graph is showing here is the store is a similar graph to what we saw earlier, but it's color-coded by it being small, medium, or large. So you can see that the small stores generally do not have the higher weekly sales, and all of the large stores, which are green, have, you know, higher amounts of weekly sales, which intuitively makes sense. They're a bigger store, they're going to do more in sales. We changed the date to a date time, so we broke it all up into three separate columns, week, month, and year. And we found the averages by month of weekly sales, and we went ahead and plotted that. So what this graph here is broken down, blue is type A, orange here is type B, C is green, and then the dotted line is it is a holiday, and the solid line is that it is not a holiday. So you can see that there is a big spike in weekly sales when it is a holiday. And then when it's not a holiday, it sort of just putters around, you know, and then it dips and then it goes back up. So once the holidays are over and we start moving into month, you know, 11, 12, the holiday season dives, but the weekly sales still go up. In other words, if we didn't have this dotted line here, we wouldn't see the effect that a holiday has on weekly sales. And it's also worth noting that in a Type C Walmart store, whether it's a holiday or not, the line is pretty similar. It's just flat. And then even when we get to where the other stores start to peak in holiday season, the Type C store actually drops. So the Type C store does not see any benefit of a holiday week, which it could be pretty insightful. It still drops when the holiday season's over, but there's no peaking either in that time period. So pretty interesting. This is a graph of a pretty much what we saw month by month, but this is week by week. So this gives us a little more granularity about what is happening on those weeks where it's not a holiday. And once we get right to about week 38, 39, is where we start to see the holiday peaking season happen. But it's cool because we can actually see where it really starts to dive at the beginning of the year, and then it starts to go up. And then we can start seeing the different bumps throughout the different weeks. And it's the same story even with the different types. So this here is just preparing the data. We dropped the category size because that wasn't part of the original data. It was a numeric value, so I wanted to replace that size. And we encoded the categories columns so that when we ran an analysis of correlation, we could do so. So this is the heat map correlation matrix here. I know it's kind of hard to fit all in one graph or in one, you know, screen here. But basically where you see a darker green is where you see a higher correlation. So if our target column here is weekly sales, we can look across here and see where what features amongst the data frame correlate higher. So we have a 0.24 here and a 0.18 here. If we scroll down to see what features those are, that's type and size. So type and size are highly correlated to our weekly sales. Makes sense. That's the type of store that you're operating in and the size. We can also say that like markdowns are very closely correlated with one another. That could create a multi-corollarity issue, which I've addressed later down here by dropping the markdown 4 so that we're not correlating like similar features. We then created a copy of the data frame and prepared it to test it and split it. So the other thing that I did was drop the date column because we already have a month, year, and week column, and then separated it out, you know, pretty simple, you know, straightforward split here, scaled it. We're going to first try random forest, and our results were okay. You know, you can see here, this is the line where we want the dots to be as close to the line as possible. And x-axis here is predicted, true is the y-axis. So yeah, we want the dots to be as close to the line. And we did a features importance, department, size, store. Clearly those are the things, the week. These are things that clearly are the most important features to the data set that the random forest model thinks helps make its predictions. And here we have some metrics. So the test accuracy score here is 97.3%. We have a root mean squared error of 3698, and we have a mean absolute error of 1456. So just different metric scores here to give us an idea of how to improve and how to make things better. I went ahead and did a grid search on the random forest regressor here. We're going to just do a fold twice. And we're going to go ahead and refit it, predict it, and see what we get. And as you can see, we got a much, much better result here where almost everything is on the line. It's only when we get out to the upper levels of the weekly sales that it's predicting wrong here. But we got a 99% accuracy rate here. Our root mean squared error is 1364, and our mean absolute error was 519, excuse me. Definitely definitely a lot better score there. I went ahead and also did just a XG boost regressor model to see if that would give us any better results than the out of the box. But it actually got us a 94% there, so it just wasn't working as well. So definitely the random forest here with the grid search was the way to go and getting us the sort of predictive analysis that we want. Anywho, I hope you found that sort of interesting. Something that I would like to do later on with this is do a time series analysis where we split by the date and we do go along that route. Stay tuned if you want to see that video, and if you have any questions, just let me know in the comments. And until the next video, take care. See ya. Bye.